Eid Mubarak. Welcome to GPR31. Ya Rab, wo na samjhe hai na samjhenge meri baat. Ya Rab, wo na samjhe hai na samjhenge meri baat. De aur dil unko jo na de mujhko zubaan aur. Oh God, oh Lord, they will not understand what I'm trying to say. Either give them a different heart or give me a different tongue. This is something which I sort of find myself saying often, and especially when I am recording this series on understandings of reality, because most people don't understand what I'm trying to say. But fine, someday some people will understand. That's good enough. So, we've talked about the four different ways in which we try to understand reality. That's art, including literature and poetry, philosophy, science, and religion. All four of them have different claims to reality. These I mentioned in increasing order of claims on reality, and different mixture of reality and storytelling. Storytelling itself is a mix of entertainment and creativity. So we've talked about that in the previous rant. We will now talk specifically about Islam. As we understood previously, Islam belongs to the Abrahamic family of religions. There are about 24% of this world adheres to Islam. This rant is addressed to non-believers, because different believers believe in different things, and obviously all of them will have a lot of problems with what I'm about to say. So, religions, as we said, claim to be representing reality, while they actually do not. They are as far away from reality as is art. Religion, in a way, is art. Unfortunately, people don't understand it as such. They believe it to be the real reality, which it is not. And when you tell adherents to a religion that, they get upset, because even though it's their responsibility to give evidence of their extraordinary claim, they turn back and ask you, what evidence do you have not to agree with their story? Well, that's what the world is like. Anyway, so Islam is based upon one particular foundational belief, which is La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. First, we'll talk about the second part, Muhammadur Rasulullah. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a messenger of God. And which God? The only God that there is, La ilaha illallah. The word Allah is actually shortened form of Al-Ilah, which means the divinity, or Malik, generally speaking, Lord, Almighty, whatever. So you can use any word really, but some Muslims actually feel that Allah is different from God and different from Ishwar, but it is not. That's exactly what that word means. Now, Islam began sometime in 7th century Common Era. The founder was, of course, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was a person who was generally well regarded in the society. He was a businessman who used to do business for a reasonably rich lady by the name Khadija. And subsequently, at some point in time, Khadija married him. Khadija was older than Muhammad. And Muhammad used to oftentimes go and sit alone in a cave and used to contemplate about life. Oftentimes when he would do that, he would return completely shaken from that cave. At one such time, he was very, very shaken and he wasn't able to sort of speak much, and his wife comforted him and, you know, tried to understand what he's trying to say, and he said that he heard certain voices. She tried to sort out the matter. She could not. Eventually, she took him to some person, some wise person who had the understanding of the various religions prevalent at that point in time, including Judaism and Christianity. And he then said that the voice you heard was that from the Holy Spirit, and that you have been appointed a messenger from God. So pay heed to what the voice is telling you. So he paid heed to that, and eventually he started coming back with certain verses. The first person to believe in his prophethood was Khadija, and then I might be a little confused in terms of the sequencing, but it was Khadija and his adopted son, and Ali, his cousin, and later also his son-in-law. So these people, they adopted Islam, and slowly more and more people started believing in him. However, since there was a certain claim to exclusivity, and the society at that time was sort of pantheistic, they believed in as many gods as different people who would come there. Mecca was actually, there is some discussion as to whether Mecca originally was at this same spot or at a different spot. More like whether there was a different place where Kaaba existed, where Muhammad was born, because some of the references in Quran, they actually are not borne by the archaeological facts at the current Mecca, but there are possibilities that many other cities, many other locations in Arabia, at least one strong possibility is Petra, could have been the original place of Kaaba. Whatever be the case, there was some opposition, and eventually some of the adherents had to go away from Mecca. Muhammad and some other adherents still stayed in Mecca. Then it became even worse, and eventually on one particular night, Muhammad with his followers went away to Yashrib, which was subsequently known as Medina. Medina was populated by many different kind of people and many different tribes who would often fight amongst each other. And they had heard about Muhammad that he was a very just person, and they felt that he would be the right person to adjudicate the matters there in Medina, in Yashrib, then as it was called. So that agreement was made and Muhammad went away there, and then the people there welcomed the small party which came along with Muhammad, and then for about 10 years Muhammad stayed there, and this city was very welcoming, and eventually it became the governing headquarters for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And though it took a while for Muhammad's dominion to reach Mecca, because Meccans kept fighting again and again, and well, we don't exactly know who was the belligerent, what were the reasons, because obviously the only history that we have available today is from the Muslim side, so that says that Meccans were unfair and so forth. So eventually Meccans lost, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he entered Mecca as a victor. He was very very generous, and he made sure that there was no bloodshed. And after that, Islam went from strength to strength. Approximately 10 years after leaving Mecca, and soon after, you know, winning back Mecca, he passed away. After he passed away, four of his companions became the head of the real, as it were, after him. The first one was Abu Bakr, the second one was Umar, the third was Uthman, and the fourth was Ali. So after Muhammad passed away, there was a lot of confusion, and a lot of wars happened, and a lot of problems happened. And in this short session, we can't really talk about all the things that happened, but at that point in time, one school started believing that Abu Bakr and Ali and Uthman did not deserve to be the leaders, the khalifas, the amirs of the Muslim Ummah, as it were. And that group roughly then eventually became Shia. Those who followed the line presented by Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman, they came to be known as Sunnis, as in Sunnah or Sunnat, which is being the followers, essentially the followers of Muhammad. But then Shias also claim to be followers of Muhammad, and the full form of Shia really is Shia Ali, the party of Ali. Well, many other things happened, but after these four Rashidun caliphs or Khulafa-i Rashidin, then the leadership passed to the family of Uthman, and actually the family of Abu Sufyan, who was the big man of Mecca, who was fighting Muhammad while all the time actually. And Abu Sufyan's family, as Muslims, then subsequently ruled over the Islamic realm for quite a while, and that was a dynasty which was established by Muawiyah. And then his other relatives really became the leaders, and that went on for a while. After that, another family took over, which claimed to be from the family of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That was the Abbasid Caliphate. At some point in time, the headquarter was moved to Baghdad, and the period of the Abbasid Caliphate really is considered as the golden age of Islam. During Abbasid Caliphs, there was a lot of freedom. People were invited from all over to be a part of what is known as Baytul Hikmah, the House of Wisdom, which was established by Harun al-Rashid and his successor. There was another person in between. That was Al-Mamun. And at that point in time, as I have covered elsewhere, Islam was very open. It followed the school of Mutazila, which really considered logic as the primary method through which reality and life and religion should be understood. After all, reality is claimed to be understood by religion. Mutazila said logic is the primary thing. During that time, a lot of study was done on philosophies from Greece, from India, and even as far as China. And a lot of ulum, lot of knowledge was brought in from all these places, including numerals and including the concept of zero. And that resulted in a huge enlightenment, as it were. That was the Renaissance, which happened basically under the Abbasid Caliphate and short while subsequently, until Mutazila was beaten back by a rival school called Ashari. Ashari school was established by Al-Ashari, and one of the great proponents of that was Al-Ghazali. Al-Ghazali wrote a lot of books, and he essentially disapproved of philosophies generally, and Greek philosophy specifically, and it amounted to people understood it to be amounting to be opposing logic and following the Sunnah, or following or becoming the followers. The school of Mutazila was a mujtahid school, which said use your head, while the Ashari school said no, just blindly follow the tradition. So that became the followership which has dogged Islam and Muslims until today, because for 800 years now Muslims have followed Ashari school completely, to the extent that people don't even know that that's what they're following. And Islam has become completely just about blind followership. That's the reason you find that after the golden era of Islam, approximately, you know, that era was between, say, like 800 to 1200 common era, CE or AD, whatever you like to call it. After that, there has been no scientific contribution by Muslims, whatever, because we have been generally followers. As it stands today, there are two major divisions of Muslims, the Sunni and the Shia. Sunni, almost all follow and even Shia now essentially follow the Ash'ari thought. The within these, and there are of course other schools, other sects than Sunni and Shia, but they are much smaller, so we won't go there. Sunnis typically follow one of the four mazhabs. Mazhab actually doesn't really mean religion, but means interpretation of religion or interpretation of the right way to live. So the four mazahib are Hanafi, Hanbali, Maliki, Shafi'i, named after the exponents of those schools. And the Shia school is basically Jafari, but there are other schools as well. Under the Jafari school, the greatest number of Shias are what is known as Twelvers. They believe in 12 Imams or leaders. Those 12, in Arabic, 12 is Itna Ashra, therefore that is called Itna Ashari school. The others are Ismailis, and there I think Seveners are the most. Then under that you find, under both Shias and Sunnis, you find zillions and zillions of sects. So under these four Sunni mazahibs, they have sort of agreed that you can follow any particular mazhab but stick to it. But then again within that there has been further, what shall I say, fragmentation of beliefs, whereby there are some who adhere to Sufi thought process and they have come to be known as Barelvis, and there are those who are pure followers or who like to believe that they are purely following, and they are considered as Deobandis. Under Deobandis, there are again several other, sects, and Tablighi Jamaat, for example, is one of them. And then there are sects which are like Salafi, which is followed in Saudi Arab and Qatar, and that's all. So these are the different schools, different sects which have formed today, and very often some sects believe that other sects are not really Muslim. So that's what it is. Muslims are fairly divided, and that's about what I can cover today. If someone wants greater detail, I can do another session. Until then, bye. Take care.